Jesus, we are so thankful that you loved us so much to give your life in our place on the cross. You're worthy of everything. You're worthy of us giving every speck of our life, every breath that we take, of everything that we live for, because you died for us. That those of us who live should no longer live for ourselves, but we should live for you who died for us and gave your life for us. So Lord, help us to live our lives that way. To point people to you, Jesus. Because it was your love that transformed our broken lives on that cross. And we want to be agents of your love, ambassadors of your love, sharing it with every person we meet so they might come to know you as true Lord and Savior as well. This is our prayer, Lord. Speak to us through your word now. Draw us deeper in our walk with you. And let us honor you with our life because you gave us yours. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray together. Amen. 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 God, you are good.
All the time.
And whoever finds Jesus finds life. Whoever finds Jesus finds life. Absolutely. Well, my name is Jeff, and I'm the lead pastor here at New Hope. And if you're visiting today, it is no accident that you're here today. I believe that every person who comes through the doors here, God brings for a purpose. Today, he wants to speak some truth into your life, some love into your life. I'm honored to be just a small piece of that this morning. If you are visiting, it's not going to take you long to figure out that we're not a perfect church. That's because we're full of imperfect people like me and my brother James up here. But we're real serious about sharing Christ's love with people so he could step in and transform their broken lives and our broken lives in the process. And so if you're visiting today, let us know you're here. There's a communication card in your bulletin, looks like this. And if you would, fill that out. And at the end of the worship hour, take it to the Welcome Center out back and exchange that with us. We got a free gift we'd love to give you. We'd love to have a chance to connect with you that way. So please let us know that you're here today. Well, a couple things. I always want to encourage you to look on the back page of your bulletin each week for the announcements so that you can know what's going on at New Hope and be connected and be involved. Do want to let you know next Sunday we'll be doing baptisms and child dedications. That's next Sunday, November 13th, around 12:30 following the second worship hour, give or take a few there. And we're really excited about that. If you have never committed your life to Christ in baptism, it's kind of like your wedding day with Jesus where you're committing, you're uniting with him. The Bible says it's also like a funeral where you're burying your old life that you live for yourself, and then you're being raised to a new life with Christ that really is about, now Jesus, you're in charge. I want to follow you. I want to go where you want, when you want, how you want. I'm letting you lead instead of me lead my own life. And so that's really what we're about in our baptism. So if you've never been baptized of your own choice in following Christ, I want to encourage you to do that. And if you'd like to be baptized or dedicate a child next Sunday, just sign on your communication card, name, phone number, email address, and then on the back, check the box that says baptism or child dedication. And then myself or our spiritual growth pastor, Michael Cardenas, will be in touch with you this week. And make sure you're good to go for the baptisms or child dedications next Sunday. So let us know if that's something you'd like to do. Also want you to know that if you have gone through the Next Steps classes, the first ones, you can continue through those classes. Today we're 301 is happening up front, next week 401, and the next week 501. So anyway, great opportunities there as well. But you have to take the classes in front of those in order to take those. Those prerequisites are required. So with all that said, let's go to the Lord for just one moment before we step into the message today. God, right now we just ask that you would still our hearts. Lord, we've all had things going on this week, different things going on in our lives, and right now we ask that you would help us to focus, to listen to your word, and Lord, that you would give us obedient hearts to do what you ask us to do. So draw us closer to you as we dig into your word. Speak to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we've been in a message series that I've entitled Rising to Our Calling. In this series, we've talked about the reality that Jesus Christ has a calling and purpose for every human being because he's created them. And what we're learning in this series is we're learning how to answer the call that Jesus has placed on us. Because the reality is, if we don't answer that call, we will never fulfill our true purpose in life, and the result of that will be devastating. So what we want to do is we want to hear from the Lord, answer the call, and do what He asked us to do, live out His purpose on this earth. So that's what we're talking about throughout this series. We started this series with week one, talking about why we can't stay here, and we talked about ruts, spiritual ruts. If you missed that message, you can go back and watch it online or on our Facebook page. But we talked about the importance of getting out of ruts and spiritual ruts, and we also talked about the reality that that as a church, our facility, May 31st of next year, the Mission Trace wants to double our rent and then take it up every month after that for the next several 5 years. And so basically, we believe, you know, we've been praying, God, where do you want us? What do you want us to do? And then we talked the next week about where we're going. And we believe God is opening a door. We're under contract currently on a building at 89th and Washington in Old Thornton to move there as a church. Our goal will be to move there before our lease is up, May 31st of next year here. And we're praying and believing God's going to continue to open those doors. We're supposed to close on that building December 15th of this year if everything goes as planned. And then start a remodeling process to turn it into a church to get it ready for when we relaunch our church in that new location. So I want to ask your continued prayers as we go through that process. We talked the next week about who we are and that we are an independent, locally owned and operated non-denominational church. In other words, what we each collectively do, we're not a part of a large denomination. What we each collectively do, what I give, what you give, how I serve, how you serve, putting our gifts together is our church rises or falls based on that. So it takes all of us doing our part in order for the church to be and do what God has called us to be and do. The next week we talked about the reality that what it is that Jesus really is calling us to do. And He's calling us to be on mission with Him. And that mission is transforming broken lives through His love. And we are co-missionaries with Jesus in His mission on this earth. And we talked about the importance of that. And then last week, our worship pastor, Harold Velasquez, talked about the importance of being willing to take great steps of faith, great risks for the Lord, and to step out and be bold. And then today, I want to talk about why do we give to the Lord's work? Our key verse for this series has been Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. And if you would, let's all say it together, big and loud, off the screen here, starting with the reference. Ready? I want us to memorize it throughout this series. Here we go. All together. Ready? Ephesians 4:1. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. And that's really what we're talking about. We want to live the life worthy of the calling that we received from the Lord. And He's called every one of us because He created us. We have to be willing to answer the call and do what He's asking us to do. Well, one of the things that has always been in my heart is to do my very best to practice what I preach. Scripture actually says that. I don't know if you're aware of that or not. Scripture says we shouldn't be like the Pharisees who did not practice what they preached. We should actually do what we preach and teach others to do. And so while I am far from a perfect person, and you don't have to know me very long to figure that out, you're like, he's not perfect. You will see that I'm very intentional to honor God in every area of my life. If you study and examine my life, you'll see that. But you'll notice that I'm not perfect. But you'll see that God's working on me and I'm a work in progress. But my goal is to always allow the Lord to be changing me and transforming me and making me more like Him and less like myself. That's my goal. Well, in that process, one of the things that my wife and I have always done, that we've always taught our kids, is the importance of returning to God the first and best 10%. It's called the tithe. And so we've been doing that since we got married. You know, we got married in 1994. Add that up, and I think that puts us at about 22 years. And we got married. We've always been returning to God the first and best 10% for 22 years. And you know what we've learned? We've learned that 90% with God's blessing, because we're returning Him the first and best 10%, we've learned 90% with God's blessing goes way further than 100% without, when we're just managing it on our own. So we've learned to always do that. So we've taught our kids that, and our kids have watched that model with us. And so my daughter Kaylee, she's my youngest. Do we have a picture in there by chance of my daughter Kaylee? Okay. So at nights, and this is something that my daughter Kaylee has always done, okay, ever since she started working, and she's, let's see, 18, 16, 14, 13. She's 12 right now. My 12-year-old, I have to count back from all the kids. When you get as many as I have, they all start to run together, okay? So with Kaylee, she's always tithed. So her job is to scoop the poop out of our neighbor's yard. So that's what she does. And our neighbor's dog has a way of producing lots of that stuff. And so she goes through, she scoops the poop, and she makes her money. And everything she makes, the first 10% she gives to the Lord through the church. Second 10% she puts into her emergency fund, and then she lives off the remaining 80%. Now, she's been doing this for a long time. And at nights when I go to pray with my daughter, she started asking me something different the last 2 months. And here's what I always ask her, is there anything you'd like me to be praying for you? And this is what has shocked me about her request. The last few months, here's what she says. Dad, pray that God will use me to help more people find Jesus. She's praying for her neighborhood friends, and she's praying for other people in the world who don't know Christ. And so I've prayed that with her a number of times, but here's what I didn't know. Like, she's been consumed with this. Like, this is something she thinks about all the time. And I come to find this out the other day. She comes home from Chick-fil-A, and she comes with this shoebox, and she's like, Dad, God showed me what I could do to help lead someone to Jesus that I've never even met. And I'm like, what are you talking about, hon? And she's like, look at this shoebox. Like, I saw this at Chick-fil-A, and the shoebox, what they do is you go and buy gifts, you put them in the shoebox, and then they ship this shoebox. This ministry puts things about Jesus in there, and they have volunteers that deliver these shoeboxes and share the love of Jesus with people all over the world who would never hear about Jesus anywhere else, any way else, and I get to buy them gifts. She was so excited. She's like, Dad, can we go to Walmart right now? And I'm like, honey, I got stuff I got to do, but I want to go right now. And I'm like, honey, we can't go right now. Well, anyway, she goes to, her mom takes her this week. She comes home and she's like, Dad, you got to come here. You got to see. I wish we had the picture so I could show you. Of the shoebox that she stuffed this shoebox so full. Like, you think it's going to bust out at the seams. She spent $20 over and above her tithe and offering, which she does her normal every time she gets paid. $20 is 1/4 of her annual income. It's 25% of what she makes. She gave as an offering over and above her tithe to lead people to Jesus. And she did it all because of this. She recognizes the depth of God's love for her. She gets it. And she loves others so much, she wants them to come to know the radical transformational love of Christ as well. And so she's willing, out of her own little tiny pockets, because she has the tiniest pockets in her little pants, and her own little 12-year-old tiny pockets, she gave so that others could know the love of Christ. And her love flows so deeply that she gave. And it blew my mind, to be honest with you, because I got to thinking back through my life, and I'm like, when is the last time I gave 25% of my annual income to the Lord over and above my tithe, my 10%? Friends, I have never given that much over and above. And God shows me my daughter. You know, as I've watched my daughter, I got to thinking about, why do we give? And that's really what my message is about today. Why do we give? And I got to thinking, the source of giving is always love. Matter of fact, think back about your life. Think about the gifts that you've given, whether it's to the Lord or gifts you've given to others. Maybe you've given some substantial gifts at some point in your life. If your heart was right, why did you give those gifts? Why? Because you loved the person you gave them to. Friends, this is a deep, deep, deep truth. Love always gives. It's what love does. You can't love and not give. It's actually impossible. And we give in a lot of different kinds of ways, don't we? You know what? You see someone hurting and you come over and you give them a hug. And that touch right there is a gift of love. Someone hurting or in need, and maybe you give them a financial gift or help them out. That's a touch of love. Someone broken and struggling, and you come up and you give them a word of encouragement. Sister, keep your eyes on Jesus. He loves you, and He's not going to abandon you, and He's going to see you through this. A word of encouragement, a physical act of touch, a gift, time. Someone's lonely, and you just spend some time with them, and you talk with them, and you show some love. Love gives, whether it's time, whether it's money, whether it's physical things, whatever it is, love always gives. Now, here's the question I want you to think about is why? Why does love give? Now, Scripture tells us that God is love. Not that love is something God does. It's actually who He is. So it's the core of His nature. So imagine this. God, the core of His nature being love. And so God wants to demonstrate the greatest act of love. And we're going to look at that in just a moment in Scripture. And we're going to see that love always, always gives. So one point for the message today, if you're taking notes, here it is. You can fill in the blanks in your bulletin. And here's the point. Giving our best gift sacrificially and radically to Jesus is how we prove the depth of our love for Him. It shows how deep our love is by how we give. Now, one thing you'll learn about me, if you're new to New Hope, you don't know this yet, but you'll learn this. The way that I write my messages, I just read through the Word, I pray through the Word, and I say, God, what are you saying? So nothing I write is original. It's all from the Lord's Word. I plagiarize everything from God's Word. I just say, God, what are you saying? And then I summarize it in a statement. That's it. So every time that I make this, here's what I want us to know today, or here's the main point. It's not Jeff's main point. It's what I see in the Word, and I'm just writing it out for all of us. Okay? But it's from the Lord, not from me. So this point is no different than the rest of the things when I teach and preach. This is what God is teaching us, that we need our love for Christ. The depth of our love is shown. It's proved by how we give sacrificially and radically to Christ. And we'll see that as we walk through these texts in the Scriptures today. So the first one is John chapter 3, verse 16 through 17. Now, if you've been on planet Earth for very long, even if you've watched a football game, you've probably heard or seen the reference John 3:16. What most people don't know is that the verse that comes right after it is just as important as the verse right before, and they actually tie together beautifully. And I'm going to share both of them today, but this shows us the heart of God. Now, remember, we said the heart of God, God's character, who He is love. Love always gives, right? So let's watch God set the example for everything He tells us to do. By the way, God never asks us to do anything He Himself didn't do first. Watch this. John 3:16. For God so, say it with me, He loved the world, so I want you to watch what love does. God's love. God so loved the world that He did what? That He gave. Now, what did He give? He gave His one and only Son. In other words, His love gave the greatest, largest, most unique gift that could ever be given. His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish or go to hell, but would have eternal life in heaven. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to do what? To save the world.
The whole reason Jesus came was to save us. And the whole reason that God sent his son was out of his love for us, because he knew we were in a predicament, stuck in our sin, we couldn't get out of on our own, and Jesus is the only way to save us. So he sent his son to save us. God gave his son because his love for us was great. The gift is always a direct result of the love of the giver. This is God's heart. What I find interesting is that you'll read in Genesis, the first book of the Bible, that God created human beings, mankind, man and woman alone, in his own image. So in other words, God's love nature that gives, what he desires most is to saturate us so much with his love that we receive it so much that we literally overflow it into others. That our love and our giving overflows back to the Lord first and then into others on God's behalf. He wants to saturate us with that great, crazy, radical love that just keeps on giving and giving and giving. Now, the rest of our time today, I want to spend looking at an event in history that blows my mind. And it's Luke chapter 7, verse 36 through 50 is where we'll find it in the Bible. If you have your Bibles open there this morning, Luke 7, 36 through 50. We have free Bibles at these tables up here and tables back there. Feel free to grab one, write your name on it, make it yours, take it home with you. It's God's gift to you. He wants to speak into your life. It's his love letter to you. Read it. Let God speak into you. So today, the text will also be on the screen and in your bulletin. But Luke chapter 7, verse 36, there was a Pharisee, and Pharisees were the religious leaders of Jesus' day who, coincidentally enough, hated Jesus. Go figure. So religious people hate Jesus. Sometimes people will come to me and they'll say, you know, I hate religion, and I'll be like, so do I. Matter of fact, religious people killed my Jesus. Okay? It was the religious people who hated Christ. And the Pharisees were the top of that religious list. But what's interesting was, and the Pharisees are the ones who actually had him crucified in the end. Pharisees and Sadducees and the teachers of the law. Anyhow, so here he was, and a Pharisee had invited Jesus to his house. And we don't know if he was just curious, wanted to know a little bit more about Jesus, wanted to find out a little bit more about this guy, or who knows, he could have just been trying to set Jesus up, like we see many times in Scripture, set Jesus up to try to shut him down in front of other people and get him arrested. But nonetheless, he invited Jesus over to his house. But what happens in this event in history is mind-blowing. So let's step in and let's witness this together. And I want you to try to picture this in your mind as we read through it. Verse 36 of Luke chapter 7 and following. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived what kind of life? A sinful life. Learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. Now, I want you to think for a minute with me what that would look like. Now, when they would recline at a table in those days, this is a little bit different than today. Today, we tend to use chairs. In those days, they would have a low table, kind of like this, but I'll demonstrate up here. And they would have a low table, and when they would recline at the table to eat, they would actually lean over kind of like this, their feet away from the table, their head towards one another around the table. They'd lean. Wow, that sounds cool, huh? They would lean on their arm like this. And they would talk with each other and eat. Personally, I think it's really uncomfortable. I like chairs better. But that's how they did it. So picture that in your mind. And picture this. This Pharisee has Jesus over at his house. And this woman, this sinful woman. Now, I've done some research and study on this. I really think this woman was a prostitute.
And there's some things that make me think that. And there's other places in Scripture where a prostitute came and anointed Jesus' feet as well. This happened more than once in Scripture. And so this woman came to him. I believe she was a prostitute. Clearly the Scripture says she was a sinner. She was an obvious sinner to everyone. Everyone knew she was a sinner. And you'll learn that more as we go through the text. But I think she was a prostitute. But imagine this. The Pharisee sees this woman. He knows who she is. He knows what kind of wicked person she is. And she sees him walk right into his house and at Jesus' feet just starts weeping and her tears flowing off of her face onto his feet. Now, here's what's crazy. You know, we may look at that and go, what's the big deal? Well, you have to remember, in those days, they didn't have these fancy shoes like I got. They wore sandals, which is why I sometimes preach in sandals, because Jesus preached in sandals. Just a side note. So here's the deal. Their feet were filthy. They didn't walk on pavement either. They didn't have pavement. They had dirt paths. And guess what else used the same dirt paths they used? The cows and the horses. And that robe was full of dung, full of pucky and pooky and all that stuff. So picture open-toed sandals walking through that junk all the time. Their feet reeked. Now, for someone entertaining someone, it was customary that when they came into your house that you would offer them water and in many cases even wash their feet because their feet were so filthy, and that was an act of love and generosity when you come into our house. In this case, this guy did not give Jesus any water or wash his feet, but this woman is actually using her tears. Because there's a very deep relationship between her and Christ we're going to learn about in a minute. She's actually using her tears and then her own hair. Imagine what the Pharisee's thinking. The guy who invited Jesus over, this wicked woman, and here she is sticking her hair on his feet and her tears and wiping his feet with them and then pouring perfume on them. Now here's what's interesting. We don't know how much this particular bottle of perfume was worth, but in one of the other cases of Scripture where a woman came to Jesus and poured perfume, who was a prostitute, who poured perfume on his feet in Mark chapter 14, verse 5, Scripture there says that that bottle of perfume was worth a year or more's wages. Can you fathom? Okay, when is the last time that you gave to the Lord over and above your tithes, returning the first and best 10% to Him, that you gave a year's worth of what you make to the Lord as a sacrificial offering gift? I have never given that much. I can't even conceive of it. That makes my daughter's 25% look really small. A year out of her love for Christ. Now, what else is interesting about this, a lot of people don't realize this, but back in that day, because everything smelled so bad and they didn't take baths or showers once a day or a few times a week, okay, they rarely got to clean up. So you envision this? And what people don't realize is the perfume that there was one thing that a prostitute would spend money on. One thing alone. Guess what it was?
Perfume.
Perfume. They would buy the fanciest, richest perfume ever. And that's why they would have bottles that would be worth literally a year's wages. Because that perfume was not just, that perfume was their future. They would put it on, the guys would smell them, they would attract them, and then that's how they would make their sell and make their living. So we see a woman who takes not just her past and her present, but her future livelihood and pours it out on the feet of Jesus as an act of love.
Amen.
When is the last time you or me gave our past, present, and future to Jesus. Because we loved him. I sit here and I read this event in history and I go, so what would possess a person to do something that crazy? What would possess a person to give a year's worth of wages to Jesus? Who would do that? And as we finish this passage, you'll see exactly why she did it, because Jesus is going to tell us. We step back in verse 30 of Luke chapter 7, or verse 39, I'm sorry. Verse 39 of Luke 7. So when the Pharisee who had invited Jesus in saw this, he saw this woman doing this, he said to himself, if this man Jesus were a prophet, he would know who it is who is touching him and what kind of woman she is. She is a sinner. Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii. The other, 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back. So he forgave the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Verse 44. Then Jesus turned toward the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You, Simon, did not give me any water for my feet. Remember, love gives. You didn't give me anything for my feet. But she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You, Simon, you did not give me a kiss. Now, don't freak or weird out on me here. In those days, a holy kiss was a way of greeting a visitor. And you didn't kiss, typically it was on the cheek, but it was considered a holy kiss. You didn't give me a kiss. Remember, love gives. You didn't give me a kiss. But this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You, Simon, you did not put oil on my head. That was customary when a visitor would come over. But she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, Simon, her many sins have been what? Forgiven. As her great what? Great love has done what? It is shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little. The depth of our love is shown by what we give. Always. Verse 48. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I look at this woman, and I see a woman who's been forgiven much. And out of her love, gives huge sacrificially to Christ. Because her love ran deep. And so she gave it as an act of worship, as an act of love. And why did her love run so deep? Because the depth of her sin was great. And the depth of Jesus' forgiveness for her sins, though they were many, was profound. Friends, how many sins? How much sin? How much disobedience of God have you committed in your life? I want you to think about that for a minute. If I were to give you an hour and a piece of paper, do you think you could write every single sin or act of disobedience or word unkindly spoken or thing you did that did not honor God or lie that was told? Or do you think, yeah, a piece of paper wouldn't work, would it? Give me a stinking book. Forget that. Where's the library? Friends, my guess is you and I, we couldn't even begin to write down everything we've done that has not honored God since the day we were born, especially in an hour. It would be so many. If you have put your faith and trust in Jesus, do you realize that what he did on the cross for you paid for every single one of your sins, past, present, and future? So let me ask you this. What is the depth of Christ's forgiveness to you? And then let me ask you this. Does the depth or the level, the great level of Christ's forgiveness for you, balance out or match even remotely the level of your giving to him out of your love for him? And if the depth of his forgiveness for you and the amount of your love and your giving as a result are not on the same playing field, is it time for you to shore that up? Here's what I want us to do this week. This will be in your bulletin. It's also on the screen. How much have you been forgiven? Then think of a time in your life that you blew lots of money, maybe even thousands of dollars, on things the enemy wanted you to. Maybe drugs, alcohol, cigarettes, sex, porn, gambling, heck, even a car or a material possession that you just did not need, etc. Then pray
and give your best gift sacrificially to Jesus out of your deep love for Him.
And I want to ask you to join my wife and I in praying through our Rising to Our Calling, Transforming Broken Lives Through Christ's Love investment card. Pray through it. And ask the Lord how He wants you to sacrificially and radically give out of the depth of your love based on the depth of His forgiveness to you. And to bring these back and turn them in along with my wife and I no later than 2 weeks from today, which is our commitment Sunday at New Hope. And I'll be honest with you, this has not been comfortable praying through this. You know, we're in the process of trying to sell our van so we can give a big gift. We're praying. Pray with me that the Lord gives us a large sale on that van, so we can, because we're going to give it all. But I'd been praying about, in addition to that, we want to give a monthly gift for the next 6 months, which is what I'm asking all of you to pray about doing as well. All of us to pray about. And so as I've been praying about it, really been uncomfortable, to be honest with you. Really uncomfortable. And I got a number in my mind, and I was like, man, that's going to be a stretch. It's going to be a stretch. And I've had my wife praying about it too. And so one day I said, babe, I said, so here's what I think God's telling me. And I'm kind of freaked out about it because I'm not really sure. It's going to be uncomfortable in some areas. And I shared it with her. And you know what she shared back with me? She said, are you kidding? The number I have is 2.5 times your number. And I went. And I said, oh my gosh, are you kidding? If we gave that, we'd have, how are we going to pay this? How are we going to do this? And I had like 5 or 10 things I rattled off. I'm like, are you serious? She's like, yeah, it's called faith. God doesn't ask us to do what's comfortable. He asks us to do what's right. He asks us to give out of love. Because He forgave us much. So I'm asking you to seek God along with me and my wife. I'm asking you and your family to seek God along with my family in how can we give sacrificially our best gift over and above a tithe to Jesus because we love Him. Now, why would you do this? Number one, it shows the true depth of our love for Christ. It proves, it doesn't just show, it proves the true depth of our love for Christ. And the second reason, I want you to hear from our brother Ronald Bland, who comes to our church. He was in first hour. He's in class up front this hour. I want you to hear from our brother in Christ, Ronald Bland, about what God's taught him about this. Watch this.
My name is Ronald Glenn, and I just wanted to share with you today a couple stories that I have where we've given beyond our tithes, and we have been blessed. And the first one, we were, me and my wife know a couple that does marriage ministry, and they decided that they were going to go to Cuba And there were some extra funds that were needed, and, you know, I was prompted right away to give a certain amount. And I asked my wife, you know, what amount do you think we should give? And our two amounts didn't match up. And so I asked her to just trust me in it and, you know, let's bless them. And so we did. We blessed them. We went beyond our normal tithes and outside of the normal realm. And we were blessed. Our finances, our bills got paid that month. Everything we needed was taken care of. And God is very good in making sure that we get what we need while we need it. And I have another story where I was sitting in a church service and we were challenged. And since that challenge, I have been doing it for a year and a half now. And I do 10% above our normal 10% giving as tithes. And that goes straight to what I call the street ministry. And it's for clothing, it's for shoes, it's for food that the homeless may need. Right now in my garage, I got blessed because I went to a yard sale to buy some socks for some homeless people, and I actually got two cases of socks for right around $80, which these socks are worth hundreds and hundreds of dollars. You know, so it's things like that where when I've learned to stretch what I give, God always multiplies it back. Not for me to gain, but for me to be able to give more next time, or for me to give out more, to provide needs for other people, you know. So what I get blessed with, I don't keep. I end up giving it back, and I sow it back into what I'm doing, because I know only God can provide like that. And I've always been one to believe and trust in God, because you can't outgive God. So I encourage you and challenge you today to pray about, you know, what God will have you do beyond what you're doing now, and let's catch a vision together that we can take this church to the next level.
You know, a few weeks ago,
Ronald's
story is great. If you want to listen to it again, I'm cool. I'm cool with that, guys. You know, a few weeks ago, we went through a passage and we looked at how Jesus tells us everything honestly belongs to Him, and we're just here to manage it in a way that honors Him. So not just the 10% we return, the full 100%, honestly, everything belongs to Him. So are we managing it in a way that honors Him, that when He comes back to take those who are His, will He be able to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant"? Or when we pass away, if that happens before Christ returns, will He be able to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant"? And something that Ronald tied in or tipped in there is this. When God knows that you manage well for Him in a way that honors Him, the whole 100% should honor Him, not just returning the 10% back. When God knows that you manage it in a way that honors Him, He will give you more so that you can give more, because He knows you're going to use it for His kingdom. It's not about you, it's about Him. And God's blessings work that way. And God will bless you in ways, He blessed us in ways other than just financially, because of our obedience in the depth of our love for Him. And that's what faith is. Faith is stepping out. Faith is believing in what you cannot see and hoping for what you believe. Believing in what you hope for and being certain of what you cannot see. Hebrews chapter 11. That's faith. And that's what we want to do. We want to walk by faith, not by sight. But we want to show Christ. We want to prove to Christ the depth of our love through how we give to Him. And I want to be like that woman who understands the depth of my sin, understands the depth of Christ's forgiveness, and is willing to love Him so deeply that I'll give till it hurts. I'll sacrifice, because He gave everything for me. He sacrificed for me first. How many of you would say today, how many of your prayers would be this? Would be, "Lord, help me. Help me to give my best gift sacrificially out of love for You. Help me to give my best for You." If that would be your prayer, raise your hand right now. Friends, I'm going to pray for all of us right now. And as I pray for us, before I do, I want you to think with me, what would it look like if every one of us truly, truly sought the Lord and gave our best gift sacrificially to Christ and learned to continuously return to Him the first and best and to manage all of it in a way that honored Him? Can you imagine what Christ would do through a church of people that were fully invested in His work? He will transform one broken life after another until thousands are transformed by His love flowing through us. Friends, I want to be part of a church like that where lives are radically transformed by Christ's love. Anybody with me? All of us together for Jesus, whatever it takes. Let's pray. God, we are so thankful that You love us and that You showed us the greatest act of love. And Lord, we're coming to You today and we're asking You to help us. Show us what our best sacrificial gift to You above a tithe looks like. Show us what that is, God, and give us the heart to give back to You that way because Your love and Your forgiveness for us is so great. Help our proof of our love, our giving, to match the depth of Your forgiveness to us. Bring those things to the same level. For Your glory, Your honor, and Your kingdom, not ours. In Jesus' name we pray today. Amen. Friends, I want to put a prayer on the screen right now, and as I do, and as you read through it, maybe you're here today and maybe you're not yet a follower of Christ. If that is you, I'm so glad that you're here today. You're not here by accident. And maybe you're realizing, maybe for the first time today, that God loves you and that His love for you is so great that He gave, because love always gives. He gave His Son. Maybe you're realizing the depth of your sin, your disobedience of Christ. And the Bible says there's a punishment. It's the death penalty, and ultimately it's eternity in a place called hell, eternal separation from God after we die. But God says, I love you so much, I didn't want you to go to hell. John 3:16, that whoever would believe in Jesus and what He did on the cross for them would not perish and go to hell, but would spend eternity in heaven, because Christ came not to condemn us, but to save us. And maybe today is the day of your salvation, the day for you to be saved by Christ. So maybe your prayer would be this. Maybe it'd just be, listen, I'm wrong. I've disobeyed You. Jesus, You're right. I believe You died on that cross for me. You were buried. You rose again. You live today. And I want to put You in charge. I give You control of my life. Come into my life by Your Spirit and lead me from this day forward. Friends, if that would be your prayer, maybe first time ever, or maybe a serious recommitment. You've been there, you fell away, and today's your time to come back wholeheartedly to Christ with everything, all you are, all you have. If that would be your prayer, first time ever or serious recommitment, would you just be bold right now and raise your hand if that's you? Praise God. Listen, friends, if you just raised your hand, or even if you didn't, but you'd like to commit or seriously recommit to Christ, I just want to ask you to meet me to the door to the left there of the cross in just 1 minute, and I'd love to pray with you. I'm going to ask us to stand now as we close. Let's worship together. And as this woman gave as an act of worship to the Lord, let's give today our tithes and offerings as an act of worship to the Lord. We have offering boxes, tithe boxes by the doors in the worship center. You can also give online through our website, gothope.cc. Let's give as an act of worship. And again, if you'd like to commit or recommit your life to the Christ, even if you didn't raise your hand, but you'd like to commit or recommit, just meet me to the door to the left of the cross there right now. Let's worship the Lord together.